Can diabetics eat beans? Do beans actually raise blood sugars? And can beans be used as an animal protein substitute for vegetarian diabetics? You have been told beans are a great source of fiber, and to subtract out the fiber content from total carbohydrate count. You will learn today that may not be completely true. There is more to fiber than what you may know, including its unique ability to increase sensitivity for diabetics. Are beans really that superfood? For decades, scientists have been searching for the answer to a very simple question. How does dietary fiber manage to benefit our bodies? Well, today, you will know the answer. But before we begin, let me welcome all you resilient diabetics out there. This is the channel we turn ordinary, struggling diabetics into extraordinary, well-controlled diabetics. If you don't know who I am and you are brand new to this channel, I welcome you. My name is Jay Sampat, and I am an insulin-dependent diabetic diagnosed a little over 6 years ago. So the proud owner of a pancreas that's gone on a permanent and lifelong vacation. So not only am I diabetic just like you, where we will be walking that walk and talking that talk together, but I do also have a University of Bachelor of Science degree in nutrition dietetics, and that does come in very handy in discussing all these intricacies of being a diabetic. My goal is to put 4 years of chemistry, biochemistry, organic chemistry, and human physiology into an easy 10-minute or so presentation so that you know how your diabetic body works better than, dare I say, your doctor? I do, and I will. The unique information presented today will only be found here on this channel, The Resilient Diabetic. New life-changing episodes are released weekly. So if you want to learn more and you want to be notified by YouTube that a new video has been published, then the only way to do that is you have to first hit that subscribe button followed by the gray notification bell. Then you have to choose turn on all notifications. And of course, what's so important to us as channel producers is that if you like this video, please hit that like button. According to the American Diabetes Association, beans are on that list of diabetic superfoods. They do advise people with diabetes to add dried beans or no sodium canned beans to several meals per week. The reasoning? They are low on the glycemic index and they can help manage blood sugars better than many other starchy foods. And if you've been subscribed and you've been following me, then you know how I feel about the glycemic index and the true limitations they are for it in regards to us diabetics. Unlike sweet potatoes, which the ADA considers a superfood, beans can actually help diabetes keep their blood sugars stable. Unlike their starchy counterpart, there is an unknown health benefit related to blood sugar control and inflammation, which you will find out about today in this episode on beans. Beans are an excellent, affordable source of protein, fiber, and minerals too. Half a cup serving of beans contains around 125 calories, 15 or so grams of carbs, 7 grams of protein, and around 0 to 3 grams of fats when it's cooked. Now, which beans in particular are we talking about? These include kidney beans, black beans, navy beans, white beans, garbanzo beans, also known as chickpeas, lima beans, and pinto beans. A word of caution on baked beans and refried beans. Depending on where you're from, they may contain additional carbohydrates because they are more processed. For example, a can of baked beans may also contain lots of added sugar, so you have to check the labels before buying those too. A half a cup of beans provides as much protein as an ounce of meat, but the protein content or the amino acid profiles between animal proteins and vegetable proteins are a bit different. So beans, unfortunately, are known as incomplete proteins. The term complete protein refers to amino acids, the building blocks of protein. They are 20 different amino acids that can form a protein, and 9 of them your body cannot produce on its own. These 9 are called essential amino acids because they need to be consumed through food. Why again? Because we can't make them ourselves. To be considered complete, a protein must contain adequate amounts of all 9 essential amino acids. Our bodies use multiple combinations of these amino acids from foods to make these structural proteins. What is unique about protein, unlike fats and carbs, is that it's used for structural components and all other types of substances for our bodies, from hormones to muscle tissue, blood cells, enzymes, hair, nails, and many, many others. As long as the body has access to the right given proportions of these building blocks or amino acids. So which one of these amino acids are beans low in? Most beans are low in methionine, but are high in lysine. But as most cultures already do, and they've done for centuries, they eat beans and rice, for example, together. The reasoning? Both brown rice and white rice have the opposite ratios, low in lysine and high in methionine. Another way around the limitation of plant food proteins that most vegetarians utilize is by adding eggs or any of the dairy-based proteins to their diets. Those two have complete proteins. We do not, however, need every essential amino acid in every bite of food and at every single meal. We only need sufficient amounts of amino acids each day. These incomplete foods don't need to be eaten at the same time in order for us to be used by our body to build protein. We just need to eat these complementary proteins generally within 24 hours. Beans are usually grouped with starches such as breads and potatoes, but remember, beans tend to be much higher in protein and fiber content than their starchy counterparts. And this is their standout quality. And most importantly, how does that fiber in beans help diabetics in particular with glucose sensitivity? You hear the advice constantly. You need fiber. It's crucial to your health. How crucial is it? What is unique about the fiber in beans? But we have to rewind a little bit and start with the basics. What is fiber? Fiber is a type of carbohydrate that makes up the structural material in leaves, stems, and roots of plants. Unlike sugar or starches, fiber stays intact until it nears the end of the digestive tract and is then excreted. This is probably why you've heard fiber is beneficial. And you've probably also heard you can't get enough of it. But we have to separate facts from the fiction. There are two different types of fibers with two different modes of actions. Insoluble fiber is what's found in wheat bran, nuts, and in many vegetables. It is structure, it's thick, and it's rough, and it does not dissolve in water. So it rapidly travels through our digestive tract and increases what's known as stool bulk. Soluble fiber is found in oats, beans, barley, and in some fruits, and it actually does dissolve in water. It then forms a gel-like material in the digestive tract. This allows it to slow the absorption of sugars into the bloodstream. Our body's natural intestinal enzymes cannot digest these fibers found in beans. Instead, a process that scientists refer to as bacterial fermentation breaks these starches and fibers down. It is this fermentation process that actually causes the gas. So in essence, fiber is held together by these chemical bonds that our body has trouble breaking apart. Both types of fibers just go right through us. And this is why some experts say fiber doesn't provide any calories. However, this claim is not entirely accurate. And this is why you're subscribed to the channel and you're learning new things like this that will benefit you. In the colon, the anaerobic microbial fermentation of fermentable carbohydrates results in the production of what's known as short-chain fatty acids. These short-chain fatty acids actually do provide extra calories to our bodies and provide a whole host of other benefits. So how does dietary fiber manage to benefit the body? The answer turns out to be quite complicated. Our gut microbes play a pivotal role in how fiber benefits our health. And it's mostly thanks to their host of molecular messengers, these short-chain fatty acids. So in other words, our gut bacteria are able to digest these fibrous components and then produce their own end product, which we then benefit from. Some of these molecules stay close to home inside the gut, but others travel far and wide throughout the body, taking part in these very complex interactions that produce various effects on our health. First, they can actually provide back as much as 5 to 10% of total body energy needs. They then enhance salt and water absorption inside the colon. The short-chain fatty acids are the energy source in the colon. They stimulate cell proliferation, mucus production, and blood flow. So now science is also showing they are powerful anti-inflammatory agents by altering the gut environment, modulating the immune system in ways that reduces cancer. What is of interest to us diabetics is that these short-chain fatty acids have been linked to health-promoting effects throughout the body, not just in the colon. Once in the bloodstream, they become powerful anti-inflammatory promoters. So in essence, they reduce the risk of diabetes and cardiovascular-based diseases. Short-chain fatty acids, as I mentioned, travel throughout the body and are also involved in the metabolism of important nutrients like carbohydrates and fats by helping with sensitivity. Many studies are now underway to really understand this amazing phenomenon. And I want you, my resilient diabetics, to be two steps ahead of the upcoming wave of deception. Science can now clearly see how these short-chain fatty acids benefit our bodies. So the corporate manufacturing world will try and benefit from these upcoming trials. How? By adding in extra fiber to cookies, cereals, yogurts, granola bars, protein bars, pretty much any packaged box snack you can think of. Basically, food companies know that as the eat more fiber message explodes, and if they're able to get in front of it, the more the shoppers will be scanning nutritional labels for fiber amounts, or at the very least, looking for statements or language on the front of packaged foods. And food scientists have developed new types of fake supplemental fibers that our FDA has allowed that can be added to foods without impacting their taste or their texture. So it makes perfect sense that these companies are already packing products from potato chips to ice cream with added fiber. The main point I want to make is that these fibers are not the same as what you're going to find in the pure natural product like in beans. The second, man manipulates a natural product for convenience and for profit, the more useless it truly becomes, just like a supplement. Get your fiber from natural foods. If it comes in a box, any box, it is not the real fiber that can benefit you in multiple ways. I do consume small amounts of beans for many of my post-workout exercise meals, along with cruciferous vegetables and a lean source of protein. But I do have to be very careful with the servings of beans I do eat. They too can be very tricky, especially for us type 1.5 diabetics out there that are insulin dependent. There have been many times I've woken up in the morning with higher than normal blood sugar levels because of the amounts of beans I ate the night before. They do digest that slowly. Where do they fit on the scale of blood sugar response? Beans raise my blood sugars more so than cruciferous vegetables, but nowhere near the amounts starchy vegetables do. If stable blood sugars are what you're looking for, then run tests with beans. How much, which ones, and when to consume them will be unique for each and every one of us. But overall, they are a great choice to be included in a diabetic diet. I'll create an important playlist for you with more videos related to blood sugars. In the episode, Can Diabetics Eat Sweet Potatoes? Our nutritional experts claim sweet potatoes can prevent diabetes and help control blood sugar better. They even call it a superfood or an anti-diabetic food. Is there something special a sweet potato has over the traditional white potato or any other starchy-based carbohydrate? Also, in the playlist, there will be an episode on popcorn. Yes, popcorn. In the episode, Can Diabetics Eat Popcorn? We will ask a very important question. Is there a connection between eating popcorn and insulin resistance? So today, I'm going to turn your world upside down. What are the reasonings you have been advised to snack and the true consequences and repercussions of snacking? If you're on your desktop or laptop, use your mouse to click that box. If you're on a mobile device, just tap that with your fingers. So have a great and productive day, and we will see you soon with another episode, which I've said are always released weekly. Bye for now.